like you to turn to a neighbor and share your answers for 1, 2, and 3. Turn to a neighbor. If you don't have a neighbor, I'm happy to hook you up with a neighbor. So Theo asked me, what's the difference? This is a little bit of a setup. So what is healthy eating, what is good nutrition, and what does a healthy diet look like? These are three of the top questions that come up when people are Googling nutrition. I think they're all very related. But those are the three questions that people put in into Google. I know that Google knows everything. So when we get our answer, we have a great answer. So regardless of what number, what are your thoughts on these questions? What did some of you say? Y'all had to say something. Theo, start us off.
For what is healthy eating, I said eating a balanced amount of food from different food groups.
Awesome. What else can anyone add to that? Amelia? Oh, I know Amelia's name. Why? Because she plays the best sport ever. Anyone? So limits disease, supports healthy growth. Anything over here? Thigh side over here? Soccer? What's your name?
Tyler.
Hi, Tyler. I'm going to forget that. I'm going to go soccer.
Well, I told you that, and I said not too much added sugar, fats, or salt.
Okay, great. Awesome. Anyone else have anything profound that you would add that's different, or you think, this is really what it is about a healthy diet? Great, so we've got, you want to limit disease, you want to get some balanced meals, you want to think it's moderation, you know, all that good stuff. Great, you know everything that has to do with nutrition, class adjourned. There's more than I got you. So, as we move along, if you have any questions, you can put them on the back side of your card if you're going to have questions at the end. I don't think that all questions around nutrition are difficult to ask, but I think that some are. So if you have any questions, I want you to write them on the back of the card. I'm going to then collect the cards and we'll go through the cards. You can also ask questions along the way, but I think sometimes separating the question from the question asker makes for better questions. Not that you're going to ask like illicit questions about nutrition. But maybe you have some illicit questions about nutrition. I just don't know about that. All right, so here is a brief about me and nutrition. This is fancy. If you have me in class next year, you will never see a PowerPoint. I will never do this. This is just some super basic stuff. So I came from a family that cooked at home, and we also ate out a lot. We had fresh veggies, and we were a family that had about 7 different types of salad dressing in the refrigerator at all times, and we drank a lot of soda, which I realize in this area here, people are like, soda, but I grew up in a family that drank a lot of soda. And then we take the cans for recycling. My brother and I got to keep the money, which is a big deal. I was a high school athlete, so I played sports. Pretty much my whole life. I also had some chaos in my family that my brother and I can laugh about now because we're older, is that my brother and I would at times power eat English muffins when our parents were arguing. That was our comfort food. I still love good English muffin. I was a college athlete who ate to fuel, and I also didn't really think about food's relationship to performance. I swam in college, swimmers, and we ate a lot of pasta all the time, which is not bad, but it would not be optimal food for performance. During my second year of teaching, so about 20 years ago, I got a heart rate monitor. Someone gave me a heart rate monitor. When I graduated from college, I moved to a place where there was no pool, which for many of you that doesn't matter. For me, that was big, and I had to do something else. I started to run, which was awful, but now I come to love it. But going from a water sport to a land sport was actually a really hard shift for me. So I got a heart rate monitor, and I started to track my exercise and my heart rate and my food to see if I could get leaner and if I could improve my performance in some new sports that I was doing. So I competed in triathlons, road and trail races from 5K to ultramarathons, CrossFit, and I really like nutrition and performance. So I'm certified precision nutrition performance nutrition, and I just really like to read and learn about it because I think that nutrition is something, for most of the time, is something that's within our control, and we can do a lot to sort of improve our life and our well-being, not just around performance, but around how we carry ourselves and how we feel every day by just sort of tapping into what we eat. So that's me. And nutrition, your nutrition story is probably a little bit different. I hope it is. So here is the focus of today in 60 minutes or less. What time is it? 8:15? Yes. So we're going to talk about macros. So they're exciting and they're super nerdy. And if any of you like science, this is where like science is like the greatest thing ever because nutrition is super science. Then we're going to talk about what should I eat? What should you eat? Portion sizes. Performance nutrition, cost of getting lean, because it's my favorite infographic for my nutrition program that I did, and I think it really eliminates a lot of things, particularly for adolescents and social media. What is disordered eating? And then we'll leave some time for questions. Does anyone have any questions? Burning passions, comments, complaints, anything? Is anybody with me? Raise your hand if you can hear me. Okay. So macros. This is a little sciencey, but I actually think it's the best part. So. How many of you eat fat every day? Great. Does anyone know what they're doing more research about and finding a causal and a correlation between the fat-free fad? As the fat-free fad went up, what also went up in the United States? Obesity. Fat is good. We need fat. This is my chance to champion. You should eat yogurt. If you eat yogurt, eat it with fat. If you eat fat-free yogurt and you ate 6 in the morning, you're actually taking in more calories than you would if you just ate a regular yogurt with fat. What's the number one thing that fat does for your diet? It has to do with your digestion. The number one thing, even before I get to all the science, does anyone know what role it plays in your digestion? Do you think it speeds up your digestion or does it slow down your digestion? It slows down your digestion. So if you eat fat, do you think you feel fuller longer or shorter?
Longer.
So when you eat fat in your diet, you feel full longer, and that means that you're feeling satiated more. So you're eating a more fulfilling meal. So fat is your friend. Say it with me. Fat is my friend. Fat is my friend. Say it again.
Fat is my friend.
I don't believe you. Say it again.
Fat is my friend.
Great. Now here's the nerdy science stuff. Okay, so it provides an energy source. Fat is the most energy-dense macronutrient. Nerdy stuff, if you know the answer, I'll give you a personal high five. 1 gram of fat, yes?
Is it 9 pounds?
Oh my God, how did you know that?
I learned.
Look at you learning stuff in other classes, crossing it over. Great. So it gives you 9 calories, right? It's so energy rich. It's super energy rich. But what's tough about fat when we digest it? Yes?
It's long-term energy.
It's long-term energy, yes. Yes, so it's long-term energy. But what are, do you think that most of us in our diets are fat adapted? Do you know what that means when I say fat adapted?
No.
Great, thank you for saying
not.
That. You what?
Not.
You're not fat adapted.
What's fat adapted?
Fat adapted means that most of the time, what do you think is our number one source of energy? Fats, carbs, or protein?
Carbs.
Most of us are carb adapted, but you can actually become fat adapted by training your body to tap into fat to harness energy. And it's so much bang for your buck. That's like more advanced nutrition. Someone like my husband, if any of you had Jamie Collie, he's a math teacher here. He's tall, he's skinny. Our metabolisms are very different. His caloric needs are really different from mine. He's someone that when he trains for a really long distance race, he has to go fat adaption because he needs the highest bang for his buck for energy. right? But it's super, super energy rich. Yeah. Were you going to ketosis, and it's an extreme form of fat adaptation. There's also food timing that has to do with that. I'm going to take a guess that your dad is eating at particular times and certain meals after.
He just eats less carbs, and I think he's on like a stick.
To see if he's in ketosis.
Yes.
Yeah. A little too much information about our dad, but now we know. So that's what ketosis is. It's training your body to burn fat. And you're going to almost zero carbohydrates. When you get to carbs, you'll realize why that ketosis is not the healthiest state for long term. So it's super energy rich. It helps manufacture and balance your hormones, which keep you normal. It forms our cell membrane. So again, you probably learned a lot of this stuff in science, which is to review so that you remember that nutrition is science based. It forms our brains and nervous systems, right? So fat is so essential. When we think about, right, it's hugely energy rich. Hormones, yes, when we think about forms cell membranes and sort of brain and nervous system, we're talking about the most basic functions that we do on a regular basis, our most basic needs. We need fat in our diet. If you look at little kids, I have two small ones at home. One has sort of lost a lot of his baby fat, the other one is holding on to it. Right? There's a reason why, right? It's called adipose fat. There's a reason why we carry that when we're small. Women usually carry more than men do, and like in major life change during adolescence and also during pregnancy for women, at times when there's major cell growth and change, we need fat in our diet for us to create healthy us. Right, it helps transport fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K, which are considered the four most important vitamins for us to get in our diet. And they're fat-soluble, so we need fat in our diet. And this is part of it, it provides two essential fatty acids that the body can't make. Linoleic acid, which is omega-6, and alpha-linoleic acid, which is omega-3. So if any of you ever hear about like, people wanting to eat salmon, they want omega-3, 6, and 9, heart health, there's still not a ton of actually research that says that yes, having omega-3, 6, and 9 in your diet is great for heart health. They're still sort of struggling to really pin it down. But essential fatty acids, we need these in our system to be healthy. I realize that this is not like the most exciting stuff, but I think that it's important for you to remember, right? Number three and number four, cell membranes, all of our cells, you know what cell membranes are, and our brain and our nervous system. Brain and nervous system, without those two things, we don't function. Does anyone have any questions about fat? We talked a little bit about ketogenic diet, which is really popular right now. Yes?
What's the difference between, is our saturated fats good for you?
Right, so they cut trans fat out. So you want to look at, there's monosaturated fat, unsaturated fat. It has to do with, we can draw the chemistry on there, it has to do with, is there a hydrogen group dangling on it? And so you're looking for unsaturated fat. That it's just considered easier and there's less waste in your system. It is true that you can eat too much fat. But the old idea that if you eat fat, you get fat, that's actually not true. Now, if you eat too many calories and you're not burning enough calories, that is it. But I think that there's a huge fear, particularly in adolescents, particularly around young females, that has to do with fat is this horrible thing. But it's not a horrible thing. It's something that makes your meals taste good. I don't know, do any of you like butter? Like, let's think of like a really good chocolate chip cookie. Do any of you like chocolate chip cookies? I'm a procrastinator, okay? That means that to procrastinate, I bake. I grew up in a house that had margarine. I honestly did not know that butter existed, really, truly, honestly, until I got to high school and my best friend's house had butter. We had margarine. I don't know if any of you know what margarine is, but it's not butter. It's totally serviceable. But butter tastes good. It's olive oil, avocado oil. It's what makes food delicious. But it shouldn't be something that we don't want to have so much of it, like a lot of you said, but we don't want to have zero, because we end up eating more processed and we go for things that don't taste as good. Have any of you ever had a cookie that tastes terrible? I have.
Oh, yeah.
Like just bad, and then you eat it and you think, I just ate a gross cookie, right? I don't know why I'm not judging, maybe the baker didn't have the ingredients right, but like fat gives us that richness that we need. Really good ice cream, frozen yogurt's great, not the same, right? So fat has a place in satisfying when we need to eat something, and that's really important to remember. It's not the enemy. So sort of hopefully to get over that. So carbohydrates. Cereal.
Oh, cereal. Did anybody eat breakfast in the US?
Oatmeal, that's a super rich, so that's a complex carbohydrate. It's great. Great, so we get a lot of carbohydrates. That's totally fine. Let's see if UMass can keep up with this. So one of the reasons, again, when I think about before some of the nerdy science stuff, one of the reasons that people, what right now is sort of, we have the ketogenic diet is really popular. What right now, if you like listen to any of the noise, what do carbs do for you?
They make you fat.
They totally make you fat. That is not true, right? But one of the reasons why people feel a little like, if you have any of you had like a really big pasta dinner? Or if you've ever heard, I don't know if they still do this, but like the night before a big event, your team gets together and you have a pasta feed. Yeah, you did that, exactly. There's actually no evidence that it works unless you're doing an endurance race over 3.5 hours. But it's great team building. What happens when you eat a lot of pasta or like 5 bagels? Yeah? Well, yeah, you got energy, but I'm talking about like how might you feel? Amelia? Why? She just went. You feel a little bad. So here's the deal with carbohydrates and why, yes? Well, if you have a lot of it, yeah, because you burn through them. Carbohydrates are much easier to burn through. But one of the things about carbohydrates is 1 gram of carbohydrate stores 2 to 3 grams of water. So you get 1 gram of carbohydrate,
so
you're getting
all the bloated.
You get bloated. Think about this. Go home and eat pasta tonight and be like, I feel a little bloated, right? Now, in endurance sports, that's awesome. If you're doing a 3 hour or longer race, why might you need extra water in your system?
Because you're going to sweat a lot.
You're going to sweat a lot, you're going to get dehydrated, and you want your body to retain some of that because you know at that end of that race, your body's going to squeeze out all that water. But if we're consistently having an overly high, like carb-rich diet, you're going to be retaining a lot of water. So a lot of people, when they first go on the ketogenic diet, I say this not for your anyone for your dad, but the first thing that happens to them when they go to almost zero carbohydrates, what do you think happens to them? Do they lose weight?
They lose water weight.
They lose water weight. So they lose weight and they're like, amazing, this diet is wonderful. In 2 weeks, I've lost 10 pounds, right? And if they were to actually do a body composition, they would realize that they've eked out almost all of the water in their system, and real weight loss of losing fat or sort of changing their real body composition, it actually doesn't work. So you can play with this in a healthy way. Going to zero carbs is almost impossible. You're cutting out so many different foods. It's just super hard because there's carbohydrates in so many things. But just keep that in mind. And if you're eating a lot of carbohydrate-rich food, one of the things that just takeaways is to remember you're going to retain a lot of water. Now, when nerdy science stuff, this is pretty easy. Glucose is essential, right? C6H12O6 is the most basic form of carbohydrate, so it's a 1-to-2-to-1 ratio between carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. And glucose is everything, right? We need it for everything. It's our brain's number one preferred fuel. Right? The brain and the central nervous system prefer glucose for fuel and benefit from a continuously available supply. So, have any of you, you may be too young for this, have any of you, do you know what it means to bonk? Have you ever heard that phrase?
Yeah.
What does that mean? Yes, exactly. It can be in a race. Have any of you, for whatever, you get really busy, maybe you sleep in until 11:30 on Saturday, you're lazing around in front of Netflix, and all of a sudden it's 5 o'clock and you haven't eaten anything. Has that ever happened to anybody? We got a head shake back there from Wayne's World. Yes? Funny, Wayne's World. Right, so when we get super, super low energy, we start to lose cognitive function if we are low on glucose within 18 hours. Do you know what you need cognitive function for?
To think.
Yeah, for everything. For school, to make decisions, to have conversation, right? To form thoughts, to sort of preview things. All of that stuff, within 18 hours, if we're low calorie, right? Particularly, we don't have enough glucose in our system. Now, our body is crazy good at adapting, right? So if you go long periods of time without what your body needs, your body's gonna start to source that stuff from the inside. It's going to start eating away that's there. Again, I say this, my body compared to my husband, who's very, very lean. I have, like what I like to say, I have more of a pantry that I carry with me at all times. So long and distance endurance races, I can actually go without taking in food because my body has more fat reserves and carbohydrate reserves than his does.
He needs more of a constant source of energy. Again, everybody is different, but your brain and your central nervous system, without your brain and your central nervous system, you can't really do anything. So, I'm going to go every now and then. My favorite protein, okay? So, what's really important, maybe like eggs, but eggs are a good protein source and they have really good fat and yolks. So, proteins, I really want you to start thinking about, it's not necessarily protein, it's more about the amino acids. And that's, do you all know what amino acids are?
Yeah.
Because you're learning science. So it has our NH2, our Ku group, and Apo group, and the R group is the designator for the different amino acids. So protein, responsible for our structure, contractile proteins, fibrous proteins, we can think our musculature, it's responsible for hormones, right? We had fats responsible for hormones, proteins are going to be responsible for the non-steroid hormones. Responsible for enzymes. What do enzymes do?
They break down
things and what? Yeah, I thought you said that back there. Did someone say that? I thought I heard it back there. Great, so they speed up things, they break down. Really, really essential. Responsible for our immune chemicals, immunoglobulins and antibodies. Our immune system is, we need this. So what happens in your system is you have these pools. I think they're super cool. You have these like little pools in your body of amino acids. When your body needs something, it goes to the pool, it takes out the amino acid that it needs, it puts the one together with the other one, it makes the protein, and then you absorb it into your system depending on what you need. So really thinking about amino acids, and obviously amino acids break down and they transport proteins to our system. How do we carry the majority of our protein? Where is it in our body? It's in our muscles, right? So I said before that our bodies are really good at getting what they need. If you look at someone who has not had a balanced diet, or someone who maybe has no diet at all, it's in a really intense state. Your body will start to cannibalize its muscle. Because, right, what is your brain and your nervous system's number one job?
Stay alive.
It's to stay alive. So it will run through the glucose that's in your system, and then it will start eating the proteins. Is protein a great energy source?
No,
it's not. So, I have a few friends who are pretty competitive athletes, right? And going into it, one particular friend used to say, like, in the mornings, I just don't feel good. Like, she was trying to manage her blood sugar. She was hypoglycemic, which meant she had low blood sugar all the time. And in the morning, she was like, I just need to have a protein-rich something. That's how I'm going to manage my blood sugar. She went to the doctor, right? And protein really doesn't do much for managing your blood sugar. So she was eating too many carbohydrates. They were spiking her blood sugar, and she was having problems. What do you think her doctor told her that she needed to
eat more fat?
She had to eat more fat, and actually she had to lower her protein intake in the morning to help manage her blood sugar. So protein is not an energy source. It is technically, but our body is going to go to carbs, our body is going to go to fat, and in a more an emergency situation, our body is going to harness proteins and amino acids. It's great because proteins are so important in building so much of the structure of our system, but it's not, have any of you ever had a protein bar? Yeah, they're delicious, they're good. They taste like coquito, right? But we want to think that we need that protein, but that's not what's giving us our like number one energy source, okay? So people who are on like high protein diets, totally okay. There's some a couple years ago that said that young males are getting too much protein. The big takeaway that I hope you realize is that everybody is different. Everyone's caloric needs up here are different. And unless you get blood tests, unless they're actually weighing your food and measuring your food, we don't really know. We can take some pretty good guesses, but the science behind it needs a lot to really tailor some caloric and energy needs for each person. So, what should you eat? A little handout. All right. And it's in color, so fancy. So you guys have a great time. So everybody needs one of these. Do you need more? Does anyone have any questions so far?
your snails. Can we hurry it up there? Okay, so this handout, these handouts and these infographics from the program that I did is called Precision Nutrition. I like their stuff because I think it's pretty easy to, what's on there?
McDonald's.
No, McDonald's french fries. So here's, we're just gonna look through this, right? So this is our three-step guide for choosing the best foods for your body. So one of the things is for you to think about how close to its natural, and hopefully look away from the handout for a moment. Here's the deal. For myself and my own learning and my own being is that I personally don't believe that you say, I will never eat X. Okay, well, there's some strange foods that I have tried once and then I'm like, I never need to eat that again. But when we say those things like, I am never gonna eat french fries. Here's the deal, McDonald's french fries, I don't know what they do to them, but they're ridiculously good. Waffle fries from Chick-fil-A, delicious, okay? It's not about like, never eat that. It's about making choices in a balanced way. And there are some days that it's like Monday, this past Monday, I took my two kids to Discovery Museum. There was like a Lunar New Year celebration, you know, the Chinese dog show. They had Korean drumming. My kids are Korean. Like, amazing, super good stuff. And then a friend of mine came and brought like the most delicious, like, you know, from, there's baked goods, and then we had dumplings, we had all this stuff. I had everything, just for me personally. Do I eat like that every day? I don't. But you know what? She got some really good stuff, and I thought, that looks like job, and I'm gonna try it. And I've had a couple dumplings. So again, hopefully you don't come out of here thinking, oh, Mary said I should never eat this. And this is not what precision nutrition or my learnings around nutrition is. It's about making good decisions. And sometimes you make the best decision you can. And then hopefully sometimes you say yes to cake. All right? So this has, as it says, eat more of. And it has different proteins, carbs, fats. Eat some of. And then you can see where there's different categories where, again, it's, we're looking for foods that are energy rich, that are closest to their source as possible. And then on the second page, on page two, where it says eat less of, like chicken fingers, hot dogs, protein bars, right? Those protein bars, again, I use protein bars, I carry them with me a lot most of the time, right? If it's that over nothing, I'm always gonna choose eating over not eating. But just thinking about the choices that we make, in terms of, right, to limit certain things that might not be as sort of nutrient dense as other things. And then there's the eat the rainbow of vegetables, which I always think is fun to look at. I don't know about you. As a young person, vegetables were not my friend. Now that I'm older, I eat a lot of vegetables, sometimes too many vegetables, at the cost of a few other things I should be eating. So here's what I'd like to do. It's on page three. So if you turn to my number, page three. So it says, base food choices on your goals, the proportions of your food intake that come from the eat more, eat some, and eat less calories depend on how you eat now and what your goals are, right? You may have some goals. Someday in your life, you may be training for a race. Someday in your life, you may be training for some Broadway production that you're in, and they're like, here's the deal. You're gonna be on stage for 2 hours and 45 minutes. You're only off stage once for one costume change, right? You can look up so many Broadway actors, dancers, talk about like, they're training, right? Just because I'm not like lifting weights or something doesn't mean that because I'm not on stage for 2 hours and 45 minutes doesn't mean that your body needs to be able to stand for 2 hours and 44 minutes because you get 1 minute off, and their diets are really important. So thinking about what you want to do, right? You want to be generally healthy, you know, you want to change your routine, whatever it may be, there's lots of options, right? And how you can put your plate and your food together. What I'd love you to do, you have a writing instrument, is it says, green foods I like or I want to try. Right, and green foods doesn't mean it's color green, but it comes from the green category. These categories here. So you're going to fill it in, you know, looking at protein, ones that are in the green category, foods you like or you want to try. Carbs, green ones that are in the green area that you want to try or that you like. Fats that you like and you want to try. Right, so you're gonna fill this out to give you an idea, just to give you some reflection on things that you eat. Maybe you don't like eggplant. In certain forms, I actually think it's gross. In baba ganoush and roasted, I think it's delicious. Yes?
So I have a question. So when you put green, like red, like that stuff, that's good to do.
Yeah, eat more, eat less. Yes. You. This is yours to eat. Right, so the categories are eat more, cake, butter.
I have them copied for your class. I have the index cards.
And people, there's been a lot of hate thrown on potatoes, okay? We can talk all day long about potatoes. They're delicious. And again, my hope is that you look at this list and you're not thinking, oh, Mary, I'm eating cake every day. Cake is totally fine. Ice cream is totally fine. The last two chocolate chip cookies in my house last night, those are totally fine for me to eat.
Thank you. Yeah, but how often do you talk about it?
I don't like that.
Where is that?
How's your list?
Oh, my goodness. There's no, I don't think. Oh, okay, I used to have that.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about, yeah.
But I often don't.
With my.
Yeah, so there's no added sugar, so part of it is that for some of them.
I'm so mad. I love, so, yeah, I love it.
All right, folks, how about another 2 minutes? Maybe a minute? Another 30 seconds, wherever you are, is great.
There's always things that always that you've never heard of.
Yeah.
Like what's purple is there?
It's just asparagus, it's purple. I don't actually think it's purple. I've seen white asparagus. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen purple asparagus. All right, so if you could just put your hand out down, please, and bring your attention back up here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so anything that's like in the green category or food that you're like, yes, it's in the green category, which means I should eat more of it, that you're super excited to see in the green category. Yes.
Eggs.
Yes! How many of you eat eggs?
What
great. Eggs are awesome. It's a great food you eat. How about anything in the yellow category where it's, you know, maybe don't eat so much of it? Yeah, that's in the yellow category. That's in the, where is it? Eat some of. What's in this category that you might eat? Yeah? Tofu. Great.
Tofu.
Awesome. Yep.
White rice.
White rice. So what's a great way for rice to change it, just to bump it up the category to eat more? What can you do? You what? You can go to brown rice. Would you have a rice cooker? You just have to set it to your brown rice cooker level. You can also swap in quinoa. There's like all sorts of range now. Awesome. Anything else in the yellow category that you eat? Yep. Dark chocolate. So good. Great. How about in the eat less? What are some things that you would like to indulge in that you think are pretty good things? Yep.
Protein bars.
They're easy. Again, food over no food is always the optimal choice. Okay, you do the best you can with the food that you have around you. So if you need to eat and you have a protein bar, that's better than going hungry. What else might be something that you want to indulge in? Yes? It's like, have any of you lately had a box of Kraft macaroni and cheese? Or like Annie's or whatever brand you want to call it? Like, it's ridiculously good. My kids, like, it's like giving them little, like, drugs. They're like, ah, chill it into your mouth. It is so good. Why? It's salty. There's butter in it. It's got carbs. It's delicious.
fish also good for you in small amounts?
Well, it really depends. So there's like a lot of research out there on like how much of it are you really eating, right? Like it's kind of like I was just looking at this like the other day. It wasn't around mercury. I think it was around deli meat. When someone was talking about like the nitrates that are in deli meat, and I was talking about like what's the long-term impact if you eat it. And when they really looked at it, they were talking about people like who's really eating like 5 to 6 pounds of deli meat a day. I personally don't know anyone who eats that much. Yeah, I know. No, you eat that much food, but you don't eat that much, like you're not eating that much deli meat. So it's also like in high dosages, people who are eating like a lot of tuna fish. I grew up in a family, we ate a lot of tuna fish. It's crazy high protein, and it's very, very lean. And right now, with like sort of what's going on, they're still considered a high mercury fish. So now you can get some tuna that's like tested, it's more low mercury. So I think it's all in moderation, right? All right. Anything else? What? Yes.
I have a question. Is apple juice anything like
apple juice? Apple juice, cranberry juice. It's because I don't think this is in yours, right? Fruit juice. If you look at this. So here's an apple. This is how close to the whole food are we? Here's an apple, applesauce, apple juice. As I said to the boys of Tyler, yes, Tyler, right? Apple juice is when you eat the apple, you're not getting anything. When you drink the apple juice, you're not getting anything else that comes with the apple. When you eat an apple, an apple usually is about 100 calories, unless you have like a ginormous apple, but most apples are around 100 calories and you're getting a lot of fiber in that apple. When you're drinking a glass of apple juice that has 120 to 150 calories per glass, you're just getting the sugar. So you're not getting any of the fiber or anything else that comes with it. Again, I'm not saying don't ever drink apple juice. Sometimes it's delicious. But if that's the only way you're consuming fruit, that's when it's not okay, right? So it's about some balance. Make sense? So closest to your source, it's the same reason why protein bars are usually yellow or red. So I was saying to the boys over there, or protein powder, I put in protein powder sometimes into some yogurt that I eat. It's a single ingredient protein powder. It's just collagen. It's still here because it's not considered a whole food. I used to like Muscle Milk made a powdered one that I liked, protein powder or any powder thing. If you don't like the way it tastes, get something else. It would be considered this because it had too many ingredients. It was fairly high in sugar. So then I got a different one, and I got crept closer to something that I like that was palatable, that's still yellow. But a protein bar, a protein powder, even, I know it sounds great, any of you have ever taken greens powder that's like powdered, unless it's truly like wheatgrass ground up right there. But even when you juice something, you're still taking away all the little fiber, so it would still be considered here. Right? Anything else you like to indulge in? Ice cream? Yeah, good chocolate sauce. Good chocolate sauce. All right. How much you're eating? So you have this on the last page. Some of the stuff that I think is super interesting. All the stuff, hopefully. So you have this on your. I think it's the very last page of your handout. I think this is some of the best way to figure out how much you're eating. Again, I don't want you to walk out of here becoming obsessed because you're going to like have some. I'm going to eat breakfast. I have a breakfast bar in my bag that I'll eat when this class is over. But I think this is the easiest way for you to start thinking about if you want to sort of tune into what you're eating, because all of you have a hand with you at all times. Not all of you have a scale. And I think that may be a little aggressive for high school students to start weighing your food. But this is a great guideline for you to start thinking about how much you eat. So put your palm up. This is my palm here. So my palm is of a different size than your palm, right? Our palms are different. Hi, your hands, babies. But no, his is a little bit bigger. My palm is proportionate, let's hope, to the size of my frame, right? So again, I use my husband as a data point because he is very different from me, metabolism-wise and size-wise. He's 6'4". His hand is much larger than mine. So his palm, if I cut my fingers off, that's my size serving of protein. Put your hand in a fist. Three-dimensionally, this is the size of veggies I should be having, right? A serving of vegetables for me is like the size of my fist. I will tell you, I'm someone who eats. I did a I worked with a nutritionist and a dietitian probably 3 years ago before a big race that I was doing. And I was like, oh yeah, I totally got this. I know exactly what I'm eating. And not intentionally, I was actually eating protein and a ton of vegetables, and I actually wasn't eating enough carbohydrates. And it was negatively impacting my performance because I just was struggling. I didn't have enough energy. And she was like, yeah, well look, I would eat about 5 fists of vegetables, and I would not eat like, wasn't eating carbs. It wasn't because I was not trying to eat them. I live in a house where we don't eat pasta. We do make a lot of rice, quinoa, and other things, but for some reason, it's just not something that was in my habit of eating. So I started eating more, a handful. So do this, right? This is a couple carbs. A couple carbs can be, right, what do you think about oatmeal? You can get these from fruit. It can be your rice, it can be pasta, but that's it, right? And then a thumb, so put your thumb up, a serving of fat, right? So if you think about that, it's about a tablespoon and a half for me of peanut butter or almond butter, not a tablespoon and a half of straight butter, but, or it can be olive oil if you're cooking your vegetables in olive oil. If you don't like vegetables, the number one way to get yourself to like vegetables is to roast them. It takes most of the bitter out of vegetables, a little bit of olive oil and salt, you roast vegetables. And I guarantee you'll probably eat about 90% of what we give in front of you. Roasted carrots, delicious. It really depends on who you are. That's based on the zone diet. So he's talking about a percentage of calories that are coming from fat, carbohydrates, and protein. And really, it's one of those things that as you get older, myself, this is my one data point, is that I've tried a lot of things. Basically, the only thing I haven't tried is keto, because I eat too many vegetables. And the thought of not eating some of the vegetables that I eat, I'm unwilling to actually give those up. But I did a year of paleo, which is fine, I eat a lot of meat anyway, and I don't eat a lot of grains. I had to do an elimination diet for my own health because of some stuff I had on my skin before I took medication. So I had an elimination diet where like I cut out like cold turkey. Dairy was very difficult to cut out. I drink a lot of milk and I eat a lot of yogurt. I had to cut out dairy and like grains and a whole host of other things. And not every diet made me perform best. So I actually, for me personally, I had to have a diet that actually had more carbohydrates than I anticipated. For my husband and his nutritional analysis, basically their response was, you need to eat everything you possibly can and take shots of olive oil, because he wasn't getting enough calories when we were doing some high training, had a high training volume. Everybody is different. So some people respond really well to zone diet. Some people respond really well to keto diet. Some people respond really well to paleo diet. Some people just respond to eating. And that's okay. So everyone is different, and that's sort of a huge thing that like you may see, like again, my data point in my house, husband with a high metabolism, his plate has a lot more food on it than my plate. I would love it if I could eat all of that food, and I literally can eat it all, and my body will look very different if I take on his calorie load, because our metabolisms are different. So everybody is different, every diet is different, your needs are different from your neighbor's needs, okay? But this is just a really good guideline. As it says later on in the handout, right, for men, most men, it's about double what women have. Again, these are broad stroke guidelines. This is not hard and fast. This is just a basic starting point for people, okay? So, palm size of protein, this size for vegetable, a cup of carbohydrates, thumb of fat. Just to give you some idea when you think about what you put on your plate today, just get you. All right? Performance nutrition, and then we only have a few minutes. So, your body can run on less than optimal nutrition, but nutrition is within your control and should be considered what I like to call low-hanging fruit in terms of improving performance, mental well-being, and overall health. Does everyone know what I'm talking about when I say low-hanging fruit? I don't literally mean fruit. Low-hanging fruit means it's easy to achieve, okay? Low-hanging fruit, because I think for the most part, in more situations than not, we have control over what we're going to put into our mouth. So, again, your body can run on less than optimal nutrition. Just like I imagine, hypothetically, some of you have actually existed on less than optimal sleep. Have any of you experienced less than optimal sleep? I bet you come in first period for a test, you didn't eat breakfast, and you've only gotten 3 hours of sleep. Have any of you experienced that before? I would say that's less than optimal, not judgment, less than optimal, and you still survived, right? You may not have performed at the level that you wanted to, but you were still okay. So remember, our bodies are amazing at sort of adjusting. Some really simple guidelines for performance nutrition. If you actually want to drill down into performance nutrition around exercise, I'm happy to talk to you during a free block or for lunch. I love this stuff. And I recognize that not everyone's really interested in getting specific. So some super basic guidelines. You should eat every 3 to 4 hours. The first coach that I had that worked with me on nutrition and a race talked about it as like stoking the fire, okay? The fire should never go out. If the fire goes out and your container is totally empty, it actually takes a lot to recharge your system calorically. That's what happens when you bonk. I had the worst bonk of my life at a half Ironman. Called Wildflower. I crossed the finish line, I could stand, but I couldn't even walk my bike. Take my bike from a rack, I couldn't even walk my bike 50 yards. My system was like code 10 black abort shutdown. I did not eat properly. It was a huge lesson for me nutritionally. I didn't eat enough, I didn't eat the right things, it was crazy, right? Include protein-dense foods in each meal or snack. Include veggies in each meal or snack. And save carb-heavy meals for post-exercise, right? Why would you save carb-heavy meals for post-exercise? Yeah, back there, anyone?
Store more glycogen.
You store more glycogen, right? So you've had exercise, you have that carb-heavy meal, and what is your body gonna do with that carbohydrates? They're gonna replenish. Look at these people listening to science class, right? And include a good balance of fat in your diet, right? In performance situations, too much fat, what did I say fat does to your digestion? It slows it down. So when you need quick energy in the middle of an endurance race, or if it's halftime of a soccer game and you need quick energy, are you gonna eat a handful of nuts? No. What should you eat? Carbs. So what might you eat? Okay, a spaghetti dinner might be weird. Josh K might think you're a weirdo. You'd be like, what is this? You're like sprinkling Parmesan, twirling it with a meatball and a spoon. But you could eat spaghetti afterwards, yes. But in the middle of an event, if you feel a little low, what might you what? Not the best. That's actually not that. What would be better? Okay, chocolate.
Use some almonds.
No, don't eat the almonds. They're too much fat. Just slow down your digestion. A bagel. You can eat a quarter of a bagel. You don't need the whole bagel. You can eat a quarter of the bagel. You want something that has some really simple. You want it to be super, super white. You don't want, you know, like, I know this sounds crazy, but I had an athlete a couple of years ago. She actually would eat little rice balls, right? White rice gets into your system like that. You don't need a lot, but if you just need a little bit of something, you want something that has low fat and that has some good carbohydrates in it that your body's going to be able to access, right? And a good balance of fat, yes, but at the right time, right? And everybody has different needs. So just remember that. You may be in the middle of the soccer game and you're like, I do not know why Sally Joe is eating over there. I'm not hungry. That's fine. Sally Joe has a different caloric need than you do. So just remember that. So, right, look back at the handout and think about how to eat before a big performance. What small changes might you be able to make to enhance performance? Again, French fries, McDonald's, delicious. Not the best food before performance. It's also, we also drastically, I think the snack culture, if any of you play sports, the snack culture has gone crazy. I worked with a bunch of young kids in a summer swim league, and like they would get out of the water and they would have had to swim a 50, which is 2 laps. Let's just say it took them 30 to 35 seconds, and then they were drinking a huge Jamba juice. They were not expending 350 calories in 35 seconds. If they were, they had an amazing metabolism, but I'm gonna take a guess that they were not. So also remember that like 30 to 35 seconds worth of work is not a huge Jamba juice. It's a quarter of a bagel. It's maybe half of a Luna bar. So in moderation, we often overfeed after we exercise. So keep that in mind.
Wait, what foods are you supposed to eat before versus like after working out?
So you want to go a little bit carb heavy afterward. Again, that's more for endurance. Mm-hmm. And before the most thing, like some people say you need an apple. You need about 100 calories. You don't want to get to your game or your match or whatever it is at 5 o'clock. Water polo plays at 5, 6, 7, and 8 o'clock. So you have that 8 o'clock game. It's late. You don't want the last meal that you've eaten to be lunch. 8 hours before, right? So you need something within about an hour, 60 to 90 minutes before. So because I love this one. You don't have a copy of this one. I just think that this is really important for people to think about. It's the cost of getting lean. I think for me as a teacher, and a high school teacher and a coach, this is important because all of you, regardless of your sort of, you know, recognizing it or not recognizing it, we all as human beings in a social media culture are bombarded with images about what body image looks like. And I think it's important to understand, I'm not talking about someone who gets super lean because they have disordered eating. I'm talking about people who have to actually exercise to get lean. It's actually really, really difficult. And so at the cover of Men's Health, one thing that every month on Men's Health, it's like, how to get abs. That's all they care about. It's just something for you to think about. So as we get to healthy, right, we look at healthy, right, college athletes, 15 to 20% of body fat, 25 to 30% of body fat for women. College age athletes, off-season bodybuilders, trade-offs, they have to do some planning. You look good, but you're not super lean, right? 15 to 20% of body fat. Then you're getting a little bit more lean. 13, right? So men usually carry less body fat than women. Trade-offs, some planning, may require some social sacrifices, may require effort and attention, right? It's actually hard work. Then we start getting into categories, it's even more lean down here. These are the trade-offs, right? Appear to be in good health, fewer food cravings, you balance diet and exercise, you might need assistance, greater time commitment and more consistent to exercise. This doesn't happen for people by doing nothing. I know that there are some people who are naturally lean. That's, and again, I'm married to a person who is more naturally lean. And if he doesn't exercise, his body composition still changes, right? So even here, as we get down to this, which is considered the last healthy area, this is what I think is really important for people to understand, right? You may struggle in social situations, especially involving food. In this category here, people, everything they eat is weighed. Everything they eat is gone through usually a dietitian or a nutritionist, right? They're planning everything. There is no unplanned calorie going into their mouth at all. These are high-end athletes. You're looking at like people who are, you know, Olympians, they're in CrossFit Games, they're in, you know, NFL players. Baseball players are notorious for having horrible diets. LeBron James had a huge turnaround in his play because he actually started tracking what he ate. CeCe Sabathia, who used to pitch for the Yankees, right? He's from Vallejo. What did he eat every day? And then a dietitian worked with him and said, here's the deal, buddy. I think we can improve your performance if we just take out one thing. He was eating a box of Captain Crunch every day. Professional athlete. He dropped a miraculous amount of weight because he cut that out and started tracking his food. This is a lot of hard work. I show you this not to be like, oh, I can never get there, because you can. And I just want you, as you look at people, as you look at stuff on social media where it's like they're cut and they're jacked and they're doing all this stuff, may struggle in social situations, especially those involving food. This is a form, I know it sounds crazy and it's not something we normally talk about. They are disordered eaters. Everything is weighed, everything is measured. So I put this up there because as we sort of are humans, you are adolescents, right? And when you're less than 16, things stop working. Girls don't get their periods, they don't menstruate, women cannot get pregnant. Men have sexual disorders because of this. They have low, like their metabolisms can be suppressed. There's a lot of stuff. So when we see super, super lean, like cut, chiseled, whatever word you want to call it, it's stuff that's actually really, really difficult to achieve, totally achievable, and it takes a lot of work. So when you're going through a feed, there's some people that I follow, and I'm like, dang. And I think your full-time job is working out, measuring your food, weighing your food, timing your meals. And it's more complicated than that, and I just want you to sort of keep that stuff in mind. So, anyone have any questions about this stuff? Any of you can get there? Yeah. No, it's not bad, but it takes work. What it is when we look at social media and you see someone who's like Michael Phelps, great swimmer. He measures all of his food, all of it, and someone tells him exactly what to eat. So I don't want you, it's when you see the pictures of people and they're like, whatever in your brain is like gorgeous and muscular, it doesn't happen like that. And there's all this stuff behind it that has to happen. So it's not bad. It's just really, it takes a lot of work. So remember that, because I feel like on social media for myself, we never see opposed to long flat side. Balanced, perfectly balanced in her tuck position, like doing this for 2 minutes. And I tried it. I'm very bad at it. I did not have the balance on the Olympics here, thankfully. But rarely when we see stuff on social media, when we see lean, chiseled, cut people, they don't really tell us how hard they're working to get there. So, that's, we're gonna have to call it there. Does anyone have any questions around nutrition? Basic questions? And I want to talk a little bit about disordered eating, the big three, anorexia, bulimia, and binge eating. Also, right, as I said, weighing your food, restricting. Some dietitians and some nutritionists would say that anytime you're restricting any part of your diet, that's a form of disordered eating. It doesn't mean you have a problem. It doesn't mean you're bad for someone. But I myself, for a while, right, when I did an elimination diet, I didn't eat dairy. There were a whole host of things. My nutritionist, you know, the guy I was working with, he was a nutritionist, said, this is a form of disordered eating. It's not sustainable for the rest of your life, right? Because there were certain foods I wasn't eating because I was trying to cut them out to see if it would help my skin. But those are some other things I know in some ways that people have talked about disordered eating. But does anyone have any general questions about nutrition? About what you eat, what you want to eat, what you don't want to eat? Any takeaway? Anything you learned? What is good for you? Nothing? Anything? Your faces are thrilling. Let's hope we're not reunited next year because you're going to have to work on your like fake happy face. If I have you next year, I'm going to ask you questions you have to answer. All right? Great. So, no questions? Nothing.